Hello and welcome to episode 17 of The Best Games Period. I'm your host, Jack Gardner, and with me today are Jeremy Brown and the ever-lovely, ever-getting-healthier Daniel Brown. And I just called you Daniel Brown instead of Daniel Jones? Did I call you Jeremy Jones?
No,
but... Did I flip that?
You haven't called him anything yet. You just called me Daniel
Brown. No, he said my name.
I said his name.
Right. I don't mind Jeremy Jones. It kind of has a nice ring.
Daniel Brown works just fine.
Wow.
You're related now. Because I said so.
Yeah.
Yep. All right.
All right. Well, anyway, this episode is off to a great start.
I'm Daniel Brown. I'm here to make bad puns and try to be funny.
Isn't Daniel Brown like an author?
Yeah, I wrote the Da Vinci Code.
Yeah.
Dan Brown, I'm here to make bad puns and talk about Rocket League.
That's right. Yeah, listen, you two. All right, I miss one episode, and you're both like, oh, making fun of my Rocket League addiction, which is not funny, right?
To be fair, we would have made fun of that if you were here, too.
Good point.
True, I don't mind when you make fun of into my face. And then
we never make fun of you to your face. You're literally like 1,000 miles away from either of us.
Oh, I've made fun of him to his face, and I'm going to do it again.
Oh, good.
That's right.
Good.
And then you imply that I was sick and that I wasn't really sick, that I was just like, that I didn't suck it up to be on the show. But you did not want me on the show last week, all right? I had the flu and I had no voice. You can hear it. You can hear in my voice that my voice is different because I'm still recovering. I had no voice and I would have been coughing most of the time. And when I did talk, you would have just wanted me to shut up because my voice sounded terrible. So, I did you all a favor, dropping the mic.
See, that's what happens when you miss a show. You leave yourself up to open to those sorts of things. So, you know, after four more times in a calendar year, and I have to go to human resources with it. It's just the way it is.
Let this be a lesson to you. Don't miss episodes. Punk.
All right. So, this is gonna be a good episode, I think, guys.
Yeah, we're totally on track so far.
This is Best Games Period, and this week, what game are we going to be discussing as a nominee for one of the Best Games Period, Jack?
This week we are going to be talking about Red Dead Redemption, but before we get into that, how are you guys doing? I want to know about your lives, your intimate details. Maybe not all of your intimate details, just some of the fun ones.
Well, it's St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, that's true. Are you guys wearing green?
My girlfriend is very much Irish, so that's, I guess, kind of a big deal to Irish people for some reason. I don't really understand the correlation there.
I think it's the day when they drove all the snakes out of Ireland.
Yeah.
Or was that The Simpsons?
I think it's when they...
Snakes can't drive.
Carve potatoes a la jack-o'-lanterns. I'm not sure.
Yeah, but I don't know.
We need to take a history class, fellas.
Yeah.
Or teach a history class. Either one would be really entertaining.
Listen, this isn't best history holiday period. This isn't best holiday period. This is best
history
period.
Holiday period.
Shut up.
But overall, this week's been better than last. So, hey, I'm happy.
Yeah. And last week we had Eric Scott on the show to talk about Resident Evil 4. And that was really fun. I enjoyed having Eric on the show.
It was a good episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, very, except very knowledgeable.
For the parts where you were making fun of me.
Hey, everyone else liked those parts.
That was the best parts. Yeah, no, thanks, Eric, for coming on the show. Your knowledge of all things survival horror, Resident Evil, gaming in general, are quite impressive.
Yeah, it was kind of ridiculous.
I felt like a little kid that just couldn't even open my mouth.
I mean, I told you guys this, but listening to the episode made me just want to go play Resident Evil 4. So I feel like that's one of the higher compliments that you can give our show.
Mission accomplished.
Yep.
Oh, and we found out our show is in like the top. Should I throw the number out there? It's one of the top video game podcasts. Relatively.
We're rising quickly. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
It's hovering in the hundreds, which doesn't sound super impressive, but it's better than we ever did with the gym show, I think, so.
Well, I mean, there was a time we were hoping to break the top 300, and we've well surpassed that, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes.
Are we past the how are you doing stage?
I don't know. No. You guys never answered.
Okay.
I didn't tell you about my St. Patrick's Day kerfluffle.
You had a kerfluffle?
Mm.
Yes. Is it kerfluffle or kerfuffle?
It's kerfuffle, but I like kerfluffle.
Kerfluffle is better.
Because it sounds fluffier.
Isn't there like an actual level to those things? It's kerfuffle, then there's like Bali something, and then straight up hula something or another.
I have no idea what you're talking about, no, but I love everything that just came out of your mouth.
I swear, like...
Boogaloo?
Yeah. There's like a kerfuffle is like, you know, bad but not terrible. And then there's the next level. And then there's the final level, which is just pretty much a straight up everybody hates each other brawl.
Well,
Irish.
This was just a kerfuffle. Okay. This was not a everybody hates each other brawl. So it was St. Patrick's Day, so we wanted to have corned beef and cabbage. So being responsible adults with a 2-year-old daughter and trying to actually cook meals and stuff, Coley and I had bought corned beef, and everything, she got everything ready last night. She cut up the carrots and the potatoes, and they were all in the crock pot. She put them in the crock pot this morning. She put the corned beef in the crock pot, put in a bottle of Guinness, which is a delicious beer. Jeremy, you're crazy if you don't think so. And
I'm crazy regardless, but it's still nasty.
And some water and some onion and some other spices, and put it in the crock pot and put the crock pot on low. And basically we were going to have it cooking all day. And when we came home, there was going to be delicious corned beef ready for us to eat.
And also cabbage.
And cabbage. And we came home for lunch because we do. We both work like 2 miles from our house. So we came home for lunch, and it was kind of weird because, like, it didn't smell as much as I expected it to.
Okay.
But I could smell it, but it just wasn't, like, it didn't hit me when I opened the door to the house like I expected it to. So I thought that was weird. And then when we're leaving to go back to work, she looked at the crock pot, and she's like, "Why does it say there's 9 hours left?" I'm like, "I have no idea." She's like, "It's been running since 6:30 this morning. It shouldn't say 9 hours. It should say, like, you know, 4 hours or something. 5 hours. So, I don't know what happened, but I was just like, well, it's running now, so whatever. I'm sure it's fine. It's just the timer's off. We got home tonight around 5:30, which was about the time it was ready to go. The cabbage you actually cook separately after.
Yeah, I was going to actually comment on that. Okay.
Yeah, for a half an hour. We didn't put the cabbage in this morning. We put the carrots and potatoes in this morning. But so we come home, and I take the corned beef out and start cutting it, and the cabbage goes in to cook. And I cut the corned beef, and the corned beef's like not... It's not like typical corned beef texture, so I was like, well, this is weird. It looked like roast beef. Like, it was cutting like roast beef, and it was chewy. And it wasn't falling apart like normal corned beef typically does.
Ew.
I'm like, what the heck's going on? Like, this is weird. So I tasted it. It tasted fine, but it looked like more red than normal. I'm like, what? What is up with this? So... But it looked cooked, and it was cooked. But then we went to take the cabbage and the potatoes and carrots out, and they were hard as a rock. The carrots and potatoes had not cooked, like, all day. They were sitting in there, and they hadn't cooked. So I don't know what happened. Still don't know what happened. And so we ended up going to KFC for dinner.
Jeremy, do you have any input on this culinary catastrophe?
Corned beef is roast beef.
I was devastated, just want to say. I mean, was devastated.
Let's just put
it
out
really
there.
I really wanted corned beef.
Corned beef is roast beef, just with seasonings on it.
Right.
I think your crock pot is broken.
I think so, too.
I mean, that's my best guess. I made some killer corned beef and cabbage today, personally. But
I'm wondering.
Is that why we've been hearing sirens all over Skype?
Yes. Last year's corned beef and cabbage that I made was a total kerfuffle. It may have been a straight up brouhaha. Could have been a.
What might have happened? I don't know if like it shorted or something because it overflowed when she put everything in. When we came home for lunch, I noticed that there was liquid all over the counter. I was like, "Oh, this thing overflowed."
So your crockpot has a timer on it?
Yeah, it has this like electric timer.
Don't most crockpots have timers on them?
I not ones I use. Like the more of that kind of fancy stuff you employ into your cooking implements, yep. The more likely they're going to fail on some level. Just go old school, throw it in the oven at 350 for 8 hours and call it good.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what we'll do next year. She's like, no, I'm not doing corned beef next year. I'm not doing it ever again. She was devastated. I was devastated, too, because I wanted corned beef. But she was really upset because she feels like she failed.
No, I don't think it was her.
She didn't. It was just that I think something happened to the crock pot.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was my St. Patrick's Day. Games-wise, I've been playing... I just started last night, but I played for a couple hours. Salt and Sanctuary.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And I told you guys about this because I think Jeremy would particularly appreciate it. It is basically a 2D Souls game. It is... It plays like a Castlevania game, but... In 2D, but... And it has, like, this cool hand-drawn art style... But it has all the trappings of Souls games. It has these sanctuaries where you go to level up and you start from. And when you're killed, you lose all of your salt. And you have to go back to where you were killed to get your salt back. And the salt is what you use to level up. But then you have this other currency, gold, I think it's just gold, to level up your weapons and armor and purchase other stuff. And the level design is very similar to a Souls game as well, because you're constantly opening up new paths for yourself and new shortcuts. And the bosses are huge and really challenging, but like in a way that I don't see very many 2D games do. Like a lot of times 2D games are just pattern recognition. It's a lot of like jumping to dodge attacks and all this stuff, and there's some of that in this, but it's more deliberate and feels more like you can really learn the bosses, and it has that same kind of style as a Souls boss fight. It's a really good game, what I played so far, and I want to play more.
Okay.
I suggest it. It's on PS4 right now. It's really good.
You know, I was having a conversation the other day with someone in the game industry, and we were just kind of talking about death in games, and just kind of speculating, like, I think roguelikes have made gamers kind of seek out games that have more death in them. Because I think death in games works as a it increases the tension that games have, and if you're not getting the tension from a good story, you have to get the tension from the threat that games can provide via death or failure.
Yep.
So similar to real life.
I know, right? I said. That particular approach to game design doesn't necessarily do it for me all that much in most games. And I don't know, if I wanted the threat of death, I'd go out and play real life Frogger, you know? Don't do that, kids. Don't do that.
There's a certain... I was actually thinking about this recently, too, and I've kind of been, like, bouncing it around in my head as an idea for something to write about, but, like... There's a certain masochism that has pervaded culture recently, Like, look at shows like Game of Thrones or like Breaking Bad,
Fuller Better House. Call Saul,
I guess House. Even like Nurse Jackie, I watched Fuller recently. House. Oh, Fuller House, yes. Yep. But then definitely in games with stuff like Souls, the Dark Souls, Bloodborne, and roguelikes. And I don't know why that is, but like it's almost like the analogy that I came up with, and this is gonna be really dark and you guys are gonna think I'm crazy, but like it's like a kid who cuts himself just to make sure that he can feel something.
Whoa.
It's like,
that did go dark.
I know. Yeah. It's like we as a society are just so comfortable that we almost seek out stuff that makes us a little bit uncomfortable. Even, and this is going to be weird, but even the craze behind like 50 Shades of Grey. Like, I know that's might sound like a stretch, but like that kind of a thing, like there's just
differences. Like I feel like there's a difference between what Game of Thrones is doing and what 50 Shades of Grey is doing and what video games are doing.
Yeah. But it all comes from the same.
But I think it comes from different places with each of those. I think for games, it's a lot of people who grew up playing the games where you had, like, I don't know, I'm just going to throw it out there, like Rocky and Bullwinkle for the Super Nintendo. And
a classic.
That was like the only game you had. So you played it, and you played it, and you played it. And even though it was a really crappy platformer, and you died all the time, and it wasn't fair, you eventually beat it, and you felt good about it. And I feel like that's kind of the generation of people who are super into games right now, or making games right now. The threat of death with a not frustrating death system is something that scratches that almost nostalgic itch. But I don't really mean nostalgia. I mean more like those games kind of train them to expect death and to.
Right.
I feel like it's a product of people growing up with that very specific set of frustrating platforming mechanics.
I think you're right. I'm just, that was just sort of like philosophizing. I wasn't necessarily saying that I believe that. It's just something I was thinking about.
Yeah. Well, I think you are right with like Game of Thrones and like The Walking Dead and stuff like that. I do think people are looking for, you know, a violent, like, cathartic violence is a thing. Like, we have violent urges because we are human, and we have healthy outlets for that now in media and art and entertainment.
Yeah, I think media in general is just kind of going through that phase. Like, they went through all kinds of phases, and sure, there's been those dark type moments in media before, but mostly that was saved for movies.
Yeah.
And it's just, right now, I think that the mainstream cool concept is to have that, and it appeals to people, and I think it'll change. Just like in the 80s and 90s, cheesy comedy sitcoms were, you know, the thing. In the early 2000s, it was dramas, like, you know, crime dramas and things like that.
Yeah.
Now it's some pretty dark stuff, but something else will come up. It'll come around.
Well, and remember, guys, it's not TV, it's HBO.
Well, The Walking Dead is TV, and, you know, like Netflix, like, you know, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, those are pretty dark movies for comics. But hey, this is a game about, a show about gaming.
This is a game about shows, people.
Yes. So, I mean, are we ready to start our Red Dead conversation?
I am definitely ready.
So, Red Dead Redemption, game that released in May of, 2010?
Yep.
Rockstar, San Diego developed it, and Rockstar proper produced it? I could be wrong on that.
It was Rockstar San Diego was the central development studio, and then Approximately 800 people worked on the game at various points, so many different Rockstar employees had hands in Red Dead
Redemption. I believe it was the first big, I mean, it was the first $100 million game, you know, development game.
Yeah. Did this game make its money back? I don't remember how it did sales-wise.
It sold 14 million copies. If that didn't make its money back, that's a bad business model.
Yeah. No, I think it definitely made its money back. I mean, it didn't get Call of Duty numbers or Grand Theft Auto 5 numbers where they made $1 billion overnight.
Yeah.
But it was a game that we all played, right?
Yeah.
That is something you can say about most of the games.
That's true.
That they were games.
Starts out in 1911, so, you know, pretty much turn of the 20th century. Kind of the Old West is dying out, but there's still the American frontier, which is pretty wild and rambunctious. And you play as John Marston, who is an outlaw who's trying to turn his life around. And he's kind of made a deal with the U.S. government to kind of get clemency and his freedom. And in doing so, he has to take down his old gang. It's a open world sandbox game, so to speak, that takes place in fictitious western, southwestern United States, and
parts
of
Mexico.
It's
supposed to be like Texas, right?
Yeah, I mean, it pretty much is, but they don't ever actually say that. So,
okay. Yeah.
Well, and you left out a key part of the plot, which is the government is actually holding his family hostage in order to get him to do this.
I wasn't done.
He's getting there.
Oh,
Jack.
I thought they took him hostage like at the beginning, like they were hostages.
Yeah, they were holding them for their safety, and he had to do, you know, these number of things, basically take down his old gang.
Right.
But in the meantime, it's an open world Grand Theft Auto style open world game, except with that instead of cars and hookers, well, I guess there are hookers, but instead of cars and whatnot, you're kind of in a Old West atmosphere. So he goes through all that, does everything they ask him, and of course there's tons of awesome, amazing, fun side quests along the way, some twists and turns. And eventually, you do get your family back, and you think you're going to live this happy life. And then, dun-dun-dun-dun, who wants to continue?
The twist.
So, just a reminder that every episode of Best Games Period delves into spoilers. Hey, if people haven't listened to the show before, they gotta know.
I like that your disclaimer comes after
all the spoilers.
Spoilers of, like, a good, you know, 4/5 of the plot.
No, that was mostly the beginning.
Or 80%, as some people might say.
Yeah.
So, at the end of the game, you go back. You think that your work for the government has kind of been completed. And John Marston goes back to his family, and they live on the farm, seemingly happily ever after, and he's teaching his son, John, how to be a farmer and how to
Isn't it
wrestle.
Jake?
Oh, is it Jake?
Yeah, I think it's Jake.
Okay. His son, Jake, whatever. He teaches him how to shoot stuff and hunt and wrestle cattle, and then after a couple hours of that, the government suddenly shows up, basically without really any negotiation. They just gun down John Marston right in his own home.
Yeah, they corner him in the barn.
And there's never really any good, I mean, there's no real explanation for that, I guess, other than he probably knew too much. I don't know.
Well, I think the explanation was that he was still guilty of the same crimes as his former gangmates. Like, he never served his jail time or anything like that. And they wanted to tie up a loose end of, you know, having kidnapped his family and held them hostage.
Yeah.
And clearly he's a dangerous person because he just murdered, like, four of the most dangerous outlaws.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, they done lied to him. It was like Ruby Ridge.
Jake and his mom were already kind of on their way out because they saw the FBI guys come in and John Marston sent them away, and they hear the shots. And then after John Marston is killed, you take up, not immediately after, it's actually like 3 years later, you take up the position of his son, mm-hmm. who then takes it upon himself to hunt down the head of the FBI and kill him. Who is, by that time, I think, retired, and he's just kind of chilling with his own sons, and he's fishing down by the water, and you come up on him and say, "My name is Inigo Montoya, you've killed my father, prepare to die," and then you kill him. Yeah. It's kind of a crossover, kind of like a...
Yeah, I see what you did there.
Homage to...
So I think...
Princess Bride.
He's actually hanging out with his brother and his wife, that guy.
Oh, was it his brother? I thought it was his sons.
No. Pretty sure it was his brother.
Are you sure?
Yeah, because...
Why am I getting these details wrong?
Because either... Is it Jake or is it Jack? Now I'm confused. But anyway, the young Marston kid rides
Jack.
Up...
It's Jack.
Yeah. And he finds out where this guy is, Elias? Oh, God. I should have totally done more research. And... like, first the wife tells him where he's at, and then the brother tells him where he's at, which is kind of silly, because people are pretty skeptical back in those days. Still are, as they should be. But he gets there, and, basically, yeah, he does... The part where John actually settles down on his farm, and he's trying to make a legit run of it, like, he's really trying to teach Jack, you know, not to be an outlaw. You know, not to go that route, and so on and so forth. But in the end, it really didn't matter. He decided to avenge his father's death and took it upon himself and straight up killed the dude.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's pretty much the story. But the gameplay and the world and everything else is what I think is the what makes this game stand out.
I mean, that's not to say that the story is not exceptional, though.
The story is exceptional.
We don't have to dwell on the story, but it really is an excellent video game story. And I think what I find most impressive about the story in Red Dead Redemption is that it's an open world game where the story is efficiently told. You don't feel like there's a lot of fluff in the story.
Well,
there is some. But...
You did it. Okay, I'm going to remind you of something here. You did say
Mexico.
You could take out the entire Mexico part.
Yeah, Mexico. I know.
Daniel, you did say that.
You're right. Okay, you're right. But I think, actually, like, that's not what I found most impressive, though. What I really found most impressive was that I feel like the game straddles the line of not... crap, what's the word? What's the word? What's that term?
The bird.
Dissonance.
Ludonarrative dissonance.
Ludonarrative dissonance, thank you.
The buzzword when this game came out.
Yes, that freaking term. I think that this game actually avoids ludonarrative dissonance pretty well. Because... I never, maybe it was just the way I played as John Marston, but I never felt like John Marston was a Grand Theft Auto protagonist. Like, I always felt like he was a pretty noble guy for the most part. Mm-hmm. And when he was fighting people, it was typically because he had to, and that was just kind of the way that world was. And,
you know,
this is a very fictionalized version of the West. I understand that people weren't just going around killing everybody in the West, but...
I'm going to slightly disagree with you.
Okay.
Because I think one of the interesting things that Red Dead Redemption does with its narrative is it kind of prevent... I think it presents John Marston as kind of like the true neutral. Like, a lot of the events that you come across in the game, you can help or you cannot. Like, if you're really set on getting somewhere and riding your horse, you don't have to stop and, like, help out a stage, like, you know, help out some people that are getting robbed by highwaymen or something. You don't have to help someone that's being chased down by wolves. Like, right. You can if you want, but ultimately that decision is left up to the player.
That's what I mean.
But it does have, like, that Paragon Renegade type of morality system where those things do matter to a degree.
Well, the thing I'm trying to get at is that I think in every one of these, in basically every section of the game, John Marston is kind of presented with, like, he walks into a situation and there are competing ideologies that are... I think Rockstar kind of structured it with, kind of specifically American ideologies, like patriotism versus, like pragmatism, like stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
In the Mexico segment, it tries to portray the rebels as just as bad as the dictatorship. Or at least in some ways equivalent.
It does, but it doesn't do that like at the same time. Like you learn, if right. I remember right, that the rebellion, which is somewhat socialist, trying to overthrow the tyrant dictatorship.
Yeah.
You tend to, like, he sides with both and finds out they're both pretty messed up, and in the end, the guy that gets the power, the socialist, becomes a tyrant anyway, so
yeah, so it's just kind of like, I don't think that the game goes to I think that the game does go to some trouble to make John Marston look noble, but you always have to remember that he came from being just as bad as the people that he's hunting down,
right, which is why it works. Here's the thing, I played him as noble,
right?
And maybe noble is the wrong word for it. Maybe consistent is a better word for it.
Yeah.
And just a man of his own principles, whatever those may be. And you can kind of play him by whatever principles you want him to go by.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you want him to be a scoundrel, you can play him that way. And it still works. And it's still consistent with how the story plays out.
Okay.
And the same goes when you play him the way I played him. And it's impressive to me, anyway, that they found the balance of both sides of his personality and made them both work. And because he comes from that dark background, it justifies either existence.
Right.
Correct. But the game does kind of make a point to make it seem like he is an outlaw trying to change his ways, and
yeah,
and he was given this opportunity. I totally, like in any other situation, I totally play as the noble side if I can. There was one time, though, to get a certain trophy, I did leave the nun on the railroad tracks. and then I...
Look, he was just really mad that day.
And then I reloaded an earlier save... And that was just so I could get that trophy. But, yeah. I think that there's, nobility, political undertones that are definitely in the game, but that's not the point of the game, and I don't think that's what makes the game shine. It's just fun. It's fun to explore the wide-open wilderness. It's, it's cool when he sees Bonnie McFarlane and says, hey... I mean, hey, let's say it. We all love Bonnie McFarlane. I still got a poster of her in my garage. But he's like, I'm a married man. And, he just doesn't go there. I'm pretty sure the game never lets you go there.
Yep.
But it's just, to me, I could see that he really wanted to get out of that outlaw lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And, of course, today, that's not really something you can ever leave behind. But back then, you kind of could.
Yeah.
And... I wanted to just live on the farm and grow corn, rustle cattle, or not rustle cattle, because that's outlaw, wrangle cattle, and shoot crows off of my silo. I mean, that's what I wanted to do. I thought that part was neat.
Yeah.
But no, that just didn't work out.
Well...
And I think the other interesting thing is that... you can never actually, like, sleep with a prostitute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which, for a Rockstar game, like, they obviously have no problem with having that kind of feature in their game.
Yeah.
And the fact that they don't have it in Red Dead Redemption says something about how they want John Marston's character to be represented.
I think this is a really interesting game to think of in Rockstar's, like, larger context, because a lot of people look at, like, Grand Theft Auto 4 and 5, and it's very clear how cynical they are about America in particular. Like, mm-hmm. a lot of their games deal with American culture and cynically looking at it. And I can't tell if... I feel a little bit of that cynicism in Red Dead Redemption.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like everyone is terrible. Or
definitely.
An attempt
there
to...
There are a
kind
lot of idiots.
Yeah. But I can't tell if it's, like, dulled a little bit and, like, Red Dead Redemption is a little bit more sincere, or if the setting and the ideas that they're kind of playing around with are just much more removed in the past, and so the cynicism doesn't come through as much.
I think the latter, in that case.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Well, I think maybe in Grand Theft Auto, they're, you know, it's more modern. I think they show some cynicism in Red Dead Redemption, and maybe that's meant to lead up to get to the point where, you know, Rockstar feels how America is now.
Mm-hmm.
But at the time, it was still a new country. It was a new experiment in democracy, and you know, there wasn't quite all the American tropes that you see in the modern GTA games. I don't know that that's intentional or not, and I don't really care. I don't really get, like, when games have politics in them, as much as I love politics, I don't get too wrapped up in it. I just like to have fun and play the games. Like, the Grand Theft Auto games, I don't not play them because I don't like the way they make fun of America. It's just not necessarily my style of entertainment.
Yeah, I will say that I'm not typically a huge fan of Rockstar games, which is a shame because I think they're really great craftspeople. Like, they make really high-quality stuff that's
mm-hmm.
generally pretty interesting, but I find it very hard to get into them. Kind of like, I find it very hard to get into the Witcher series of games, even though I recognize that they're really well-made.
Which is an interesting parallel to Red Dead Redemption.
Yeah.
Especially Witcher 3.
Exactly. I think... I guess part of my thought, my feelings on Red Dead Redemption are at least partially colored by the fact that I really, really like Westerns.
Yeah.
Like, a lot.
Me too. Yeah. And the history of the Old West, and I think that's where it really resonates for me personally as well.
So when I guess when I play Red Dead Redemption, I view the, like, kind of the entire thing as, if people listening are familiar with the Man with No Name trilogy, with Clint Eastwood, and more specifically the A Fistful of Dollars, the first one, where Clint Eastwood essentially comes into this town and he's just a neutral character and finds out that these two families are warring with each other, and he plays them off each other to kind of come out on top himself. And in the process, he also does some good deeds by, like, you know, freeing this family to allow them to escape. And protecting the few good people in town. But, and that's kind of how I view a lot of the isolated situations in Red Dead Redemption, is John Marston coming in as kind of a neutral character and finding these two different ideas at work. And either playing them off of each other or allowing the player to decide which side they come down on. Which I think is really interesting. I really like that. I wish more games were like that in a Wild West setting, because I would play that. I would play that all day.
Yeah. I feel as awesome as playing as John Marston was, I think some of the alternate characters, the side characters in this game really shine through as well, like Irish. and the guy that hunted the graves, you know, that liked hanging out with the dead people more than the live people.
Yep.
Bonnie, even Dutch, who totally reminds me of Sullivan, still, for whatever reason, from the Uncharted series, and just a few others are pretty cool. I mean,
well,
they're not playable characters. Yeah.
You mentioned Bonnie McFarlane, and she's easily one of my most favorite female characters in ages.
Yeah.
Like, I think she's one of the, just
for sure,
excellently written.
Yeah, I would agree.
Strong, independent Irish lady who don't take no sass.
No.
And it. Oh,
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day, Irish ladies listening. Or non-Irish ladies.
And the professor, the crazy professor, who could forget about the crazy professor.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the guy who just injects himself with heroin all the time.
Cocaine, come on now.
Oh, cocaine, sorry. Yes.
And he's, I mean, slightly racist, I guess.
You know, he's, yeah.
The savages.
Oh, and he's using...
he's pretty racist.
He's using, like, that... the skull measuring technique that they show off in Django Unchained.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's pretty racist.
So, like, the gameplay, like, the Deadeye thing totally reminds me of Vats from, like, Fallout. Which is...
yeah.
Which is cool. I mean, I like that. I thought the game was pretty fluid, like, you know, being able to ride a horse, go off into these landscapes that were way off into the distance. And when I played it, I didn't really see too many graphical concerns, like the draw distance or whatever they call that. Was pretty good.
Yeah.
But yeah, the things you could do on a horse to turn around and shoot and do all these other things, I thought was done pretty well. Like, I guess what I'm saying is it worked really well. I mean, they're a game that had a big scope, and it was pretty ambitious. And it was on, you know, obviously PlayStation 3, Xbox 360, a couple years into their lifespans, and it pulled it off pretty well.
I guess if I had, I think you're right, but I also think that for pulling it off really well, I think that the length of the game eventually kind of exhausts your gameplay options, especially if you're pursuing side quests.
Yeah.
Where eventually you're walking into a town and you're just kind of like, you see the seams of the game. Like, you understand, like, mechanically how all these NPCs are kind of working.
Yeah.
And I feel like that it wears a bit thin by the time you're about to finish. Because the game is very long. It is very long.
Oh, if you do most of the side quests and the main story, it's a good 120, 130 hours, at least it was for me.
Yeah.
You can, you know, I'm a mainliner, so you guys know that.
Yep.
So you can finish the campaign in 20 hours.
That's still a pretty long game.
But that's not fun. You miss...
This is. This is a lot of fun.
You miss so much of the good stuff. But was the game not just fun start to finish for both of you guys, honestly?
Definitely.
A lot of it was, but I will say that I didn't like the duel mechanics.
The duel mechanics were ridiculous. I never did figure them out. To this day, I can't figure them out.
Yeah. I wanted them so badly to be cool that I think I tricked myself for a while into liking them. But eventually I realized, they're not great.
Yeah, I don't get them. I really don't.
And to be honest, I didn't really even use the Deadeye very often either. I mean, I understood how to use it. It wasn't the same as the duel, like, but I didn't find it to be all that fun. I would have rather just play as a straight third-person shooter instead of using the Deadeye.
Yeah, well, as I recall, it wasn't really necessary to do that most of the time.
No, it wasn't, definitely. There were a few instances where they encouraged you to use it, and I did, but when I didn't have to use it, I typically didn't, but I still found the game to be really fun, and compared to the Grand Theft Auto games to that point, the gunplay was far and above what those games had done.
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, I think Grand Theft Auto had lots of different things to focus on, and since you couldn't get into a, you know, any given car and drive 19,000 miles an hour in this game, they could focus more on the gunplay and the cover and those sorts of things. But I think, like, just from a research point of view, I think Rockstar did a good job of really portraying America during the turn of the century. Like, it seems to me like that's really how it felt. I mean, I wasn't there, obviously, but...
So, I feel like this game is less trying for historical accuracy than it is trying for what modern people think of the West.
Sure.
That has, maybe that's part of, like, what Rockstar is going for with, like, a critique of American culture is, like, this isn't American history, it's what modern Americans think American history is.
Yeah, I was thinking more landscape and just, you know... The openness and vastness of it. But yeah, that definitely resonated with me. And on the other end, once you get to the Mexico area, I mean, that was kind of racist in many ways. Or could portrayed to be that way. And, you know, that may have been planned, it may not have, but it is there.
I feel like Rockstar is kind of in touch with those issues. Like, I feel like they know, they're the kind of developers that I usually feel like they know what they're doing when they're displaying something. Like, they're purposely pushing buttons.
I kind of think they're still upset over the American Revolution, but what do I know?
I think one of the themes of Red Dead Redemption is the Industrial Revolution sort of spreading its influence throughout the country. And, you know, you see that as the game goes along, you see cars in a few different cutscenes. And I think the FBI guy specifically represents that progress, that slow march of progress throughout the country. And John Marston is sort of resistant to it, as are a lot of people in that area in the game world anyway. And there's almost like a parallel between the FBI gunning down John Marston and the Industrial Revolution sort of slowly moving across the United States. Like, there's definitely an allegory to be made there, a metaphor anyway.
Well, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like, as that progress moves across the West, you know, it's the end of an era. It's the end, like, that progress ended the way a lot of people lived their lives up until that point. It created towns, it destroyed towns.
Yeah.
Right.
That is literally what happens to John Marston. Like, his old way of life, his life, you know, is ended because progress demands it.
Yep.
If you, like, in the opening scene when he's on the train and he's just kind of listening to those rich old ladies behind him and whatnot, and they're talking about these new flying machines, and he's kind of just, like, rolling his eyes. And then by the end of the game, he's talking to his son, and he's telling him about these flying machines, and he's like, yeah, everybody knows about that, Pa. They're going to be doing a demonstration across the country sometime. And he's, like, totally cool and okay with it.
Right.
I can't put into words, like, how brilliant that is to go from that point to that point with just something as simple as an airplane. And I think that speaks to Marston's evolution as really wanting to just be a homebody, a parent, a husband, and whatnot. And
that's,
it
really
is
good
happening.
Observation.
The world is changing.
Yeah.
He wants to be
a family
man. I love
this game. I played the crap out of this game. I remember it very well.
Yeah. I'm glad that we all picked up on that, because it's subtly delivered, but I think it's a really important observation about the story of that game.
You know, you see some motor cars and you see the trains, but the majority of travel that you do in-game is still either stagecoach or on horseback. I mean, that's exactly what was happening in this country at that time. They nailed that.
Yeah. And I have to say, as far as animations go, Red Dead Redemption has some of the best horse animations I've ever seen in a game.
Yeah. The only ridiculous thing is when he mounts on to the horse from the back and does that leapfrog thing.
Yes.
that just does not happen. But the rest of it is really great.
I mean, like, have they seen a real horse? Those things are huge.
Yeah.
No one, unless it's a really short horse or he's standing on like an apple box.
I dare anybody to try that.
I watched, run
up to an unsuspecting horse, grab their ass, and leap up on it and see what happens. just try it.
Get your balls kicked.
Yeah.
I watched Lord of the Rings last week while I was sick. I watched the whole trilogy. And, man, that scene where I think it's in Two Towers where Legolas just kind of like grabs onto the horse and swings in front of the horse and onto the horse.
Mm-hmm.
That scene is ridiculous. His arm could not twist in the way that it twists to get onto that horse.
Wait.
Because if you pay attention, he doesn't reach across his body to get onto the horse. He uses his left arm and then, like, has to swing up onto the horse. It's ridiculous. His arm would not... His arm would not move in the way that...
Okay, that's ridiculous, but it's not nearly as ridiculous as when he's fighting those giant elephant monster things and he looks like Kratos from God of War doing contextual moves.
And, wait, no. Daniel, that's the thing you're saying is impossible and is making you incredulous, not the scene where he surfs down some stairs on a shield?
No, that seems fine. No, I'm just saying, in the subject of horse mounting.
In the context of horses and Red Dead Redemption, I get it.
Thank you.
Yep.
And when we get to the Far Cry 4 episode, then we can talk about elephant mounting, and then we'll talk about that elephant scene. Oliphant, sorry.
Sorry, all you Tolkien purists.
Oh, good stuff.
How did you guys feel about the twist at the end?
I guess I don't really feel like it was a twist.
I was just going to say, I don't know that it was really a twist.
You felt like it was led up to?
Well, I mean, the entire time at the farm, John kept referencing to Jack, you know, I don't want you to live this lifestyle, blah, 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 blah. And Jack kept being a renegade, going out trying to hunt a grizzly bear all on his own. And, you know, at first he's all, sir, I'm just reading this book, sir. And then pretty soon he's like, why you always got to leave me, Dad? I mean, you could tell that he was going to rebel. Yeah. And he did.
Yeah, there was always this kind of ominous tone to those moments just leading up to that twist. There was some foreshadowing.
Yeah.
I've played a lot of RPGs, you know, and Final Fantasy and other games. I guess having the game continue didn't really surprise me now.
Okay. Because the musical interlude when you make your way back to the farm, I was kind of like, oh, this is the end of the game. Going to get to the farm. It's going to be done. That was a good satisfying conclusion. Pretty straightforward, but satisfying.
Yeah, I had no problem with the way the twist at the end came about.
Okay.
I know people did, as people always do with the ends of games. But...
Yeah. I do think I have rarely felt, this is going to sound terrible, but like as fulfilled by violence as I did when I got revenge on the FBI director.
Yeah.
John Marston dying made me really mad.
Yeah.
Like, but not mad at the game, mad at that particular character for the betrayal.
Yeah.
After John Marston goes through all of this to save his family.
Well, I mean, they had a deal. I agree.
Yeah.
And screw the government to this day. But.
Well, isn't that the message of all the Rockstar games?
Yeah. You know, it is. And I don't disagree with that at all times. I will say at the end, when Jack walks up on the guy. And the guy totally has his gun loaded, ready to shoot. Mm-hmm. And Jack starts threatening him. The guy suddenly decides to put down his rifle, shotgun, and do a quick draw thing with him. That really just from a common sense perspective, does not make any sense. But you know, it was cool.
Well, that's because Rockstar's version of the West has, like, it again. It's like it's not historical or accurate. It's like this weird place where people, you know, actually do quick draw duels.
It's almost a Tarantino style.
The undertone could be the honor of it, I suppose.
Right. Like,
yeah.
It's either you or me, and we're gonna do this fair and square type of thing.
Right. Because it's like it's a movie universe of the Old West.
Right. Right.
In a video game.
I remember after that game ended, not a lot of people, but you know, obviously, it was a highly played game. And folks had opinions. Imagine that. You know.
Opinions on the internet?
I know, right?
I'm shocked, sir.
You know, thought he should just walk away and leave it be. You know, I'm not saying in real life he should just go avenge things and gun down people, but I liked the way it ended. I really did.
Yeah, it gave a measure of closure to a game that otherwise would have just ended on probably one of the most depressing notes. Like, if it just ended after John Marston got gunned down, that is a very Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid way of ending your game, I suppose. It would be a really depressing way to end your, you know, epic Western on the note of, well, this guy that you played as for the entire game and cared about is just dead now. Bye.
Right.
So I feel like it is necessary for that sense of closure and to allow people to explore side quests.
Yeah.
Because Lord knows everyone had additional side quests by the time they finished this game.
The worst part about that scene is he, like, takes that deep breath, right? That sigh. He opens the barn door. He knows he's screwed.
Oh, yeah.
He walks out. He doesn't even get a chance to state his case. Like, no words are said.
No.
they aren't there to negotiate. They just start opening fire. It's just like, right. What?
I do like that the game gives you, like, this illusion that you might be able to get out by going into, like, the bullet time. You can line up all your shots, but you only have 6 bullets.
Yeah.
And there are more than 6 of them. So no matter what, you're done.
And that's why you're in control when they shoot him. That's why you get that last stand, because that's what John Marston would do.
Yeah.
He wouldn't run. One of the scenes in that game that I don't think gets enough credit is the scene where Bill dies.
Oh, yeah?
I think. I thought that was a really touching scene and a heartbreaking scene.
Yeah.
Well, Bill was John's best friend. I mean,
yeah.
When they were in the gang, so yeah.
Right. I think that was the turning point for John Marston where he stopped. You know, he started to really think about what the heck he was doing, but it was too late.
Right.
At that point.
Oh, yeah, I thought
that was a really good scene.
They need to make Red Dead Redemption 2 so bad.
Well, that's the interesting thing about the timing of this episode, is there were rumors today that Red Dead Redemption 2 will be at E3 this year.
Yep, and the rumors also state that it will be coming out next year.
Yeah.
I'm all over it.
Comes from an email from someone claiming to be an ex-Rockstar employee.
Hmm. Yeah.
So, who knows? Could be true, could be not. Where are you guys falling on this game?
As far as the best games, period?
Yeah, because I think it's about time to wrap up the show.
Yeah. I don't disagree. Who wants to go first?
Go for it.
I, personally, this is one of my favorite games ever of all time. Based on my criteria that a game is fun, and I think it's historically important, and that it has that it's easily accessible for everybody, I would have to say no, but I'm not going to. I'm going to say yes. This is one of the best games, period, and I think everybody should play it.
Okay. Wow. All right. And why are you going to go against yourself?
Because I love it so much, Jack.
Okay.
I haven't played this game in 6 years, and I remembered pretty much all the major details.
That's true, and you remembered 2 old ladies talking about an airplane in a conversation, and then another conversation that occurs 100 hours later.
I mean, I think it's historically important in the fact that it's a huge sandbox game that takes place in the Wild West in an era where we just all want to see billboards and shoot people on motorcycles and kill hookers and take their money and be able to kill cops in those types of games. And it doesn't need that. I think the narrative, the side quests, the characters speak for themselves. And I'm not suggesting those other games don't have those, but I'm a Clint Eastwood fan too, I guess.
Yep. What about you, Daniel?
Yeah, it's one of the best games, period. Absolutely. Jeremy said pretty much everything I could have said about it, and I think we said everything that I really wanted to say about it over the course of the show. But as far as my opinion on it, I'm not a huge open world fan, but, you know, I mostly mainlined this game, and to me, it's up there with one of the best open world games I've ever played, and one of the best stories a video game has ever told me. I think if you look at it as more comparable to a novel than, say, a movie,
yeah,
in its pacing, you would really appreciate the way that it tells its story.
That is a good comparison.
And especially just the way it takes its time with certain things to flesh out characters, and I love it. I think it's a really admirable game, and I think if you want to play one of the best open world games ever created, you have to play Red Dead Redemption.
For sure.
Yeah, I 100% agree with everything you just said. I also would say it's one of the best games, period. However, I would also add this caveat, is that part of the reason I'm coming down with a yes is because I do think Rockstar deserves to have a game nominated as one of the best games, period, and like something that we agree on, because I don't think they have any other games that I would nominate besides Grand Theft Auto 3.
I don't know that I would nominate any Grand Theft Auto game.
The only reason I do Grand Theft Auto 3 is because I feel like it's really important for where games went with open world.
It's historical. You got me there.
But other than that, like, I acknowledge the craft that goes into a lot of Rockstar's games. But that being said, I can't stomach their ultra cynicism in 4 and 5. But in Red Dead Redemption, it's at a low simmer as opposed to full on blazing, and I can digest that. I can digest it and see what they're going for and still have fun and still really get a lot out of where they're going with the story and where they're taking these characters. So for all that, it gets my vote.
So we agree, Red Dead Redemption, a best games period, yes?
Yeah, I believe that is correct.
Jack? Jeremy?
Jeremy Jones? I'm here, yes.
Jeremy Jones.
Yes, Daniel Brown?
I would like to thank you both for joining me tonight on this Wild West ride.
You're welcome.
And thanks.
See you. See, it's more American Frontier, not Wild West, though.
Listen, I just had to say something, okay? And also, Jack, let me just say, you saw last week just how not easy these closers are.
It was rough. It was rough last week.
Yeah, you had some trouble.
Daniel, the counting down was rough last week. This is why we need you.
Yeah, we can't count down without you, Daniel. We can't count down to the start of this episode. At first, Jeremy was like 3, 2, 5, and I was like, no, that's not right.
Yeah. I was like, 3.14 is a pie day? Like, I didn't even know.
It's 3, 2, 1.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But then go. And then we were like, so we do that to sync up, but do we always say go when we start?
You only say go when we're syncing up.
I knew it.
No go.
Damn it, I knew it.
I thought you wanted to play Go Fish. That explains a lot. Okay.
Yeah. I still got a bunch of crazy eights in my hand.
So anyway, back to the end of the show. I want to thank you both for going on this adventure with me tonight.
Yeah.
And thank you, dear listeners, for putting up with us for the last hour and change. And for listening to The Best Games Period, Episode 17, Red Dead Redemption. I think it was a pretty unanimous choice for Best Games Period. Let us know what you think of Red Dead Redemption. Comment wherever you get the show. You can let us know on Twitter, at Best Games Period. You can also let us know on Facebook in the Extra Life comments or in the Overblood group when we post it on there. You can comment on YouTube. You can write us reviews on iTunes. You can comment on Game Informer. You can even, I think, comment on our Libsyn page where you can find the show every Monday when it goes up on Libsyn. The show goes up every Monday, like I said, on SoundCloud, Libsyn, iTunes, and most of the time when we don't have copyright strikes on us, you will find a YouTube version of the show as well, with gameplay footage and all. It's pretty entertaining. Like I said this week on Twitter, it's my favorite way to listen to the show, to consume The Best Games Period.
But skip the Resident Evil video episode because I am laughably bad at playing
Resident Evil.
Holy cow,
you're terrible in that episode. Man, you died in the first, 2 minutes. The first guy that you encountered killed you.
We talked about it on the show, but I played the game using the Wii remote.
Do you even game, bro?
I played through that game using the Wii remote. I don't know how to use the controller to play this tanky game.
You should try it with the Zeebo remote.
I would love to play it with the Zeebo remote.
Yeah, that's
Daniel, what did you think of that Zeebo conversation? Have you heard of the Zeebo?
No, I had never heard of that. I saw the picture of it on the video, though. That was interesting.
Yeah.
I had never heard of that. But anyway, Red Dead Redemption was not on the Zeebo. But you can come back next week for a game that might have been on the Zeebo. I don't know. We're going to be talking about Singularity, which was a Raven-developed first-person shooter. Raven used to make first-person shooters, don't you know? They didn't just make multiplayer maps for Call of Duty. And when they were doing that, they made a pretty great Bioshock-esque game called Singularity. So come back for that one. It should be a good episode.
Until next time, I hate that game.
You do. Until next time, thank you for listening to The Best Games Period.
That was a nice honky added at the end.
I know, that was really good timing.
They say he appeared in a doorway, boomerangs at his sides, the fate that he would defy. A Mega Man is coming to die. Now there's too much at stake. Can he fall? It was then that the crowd saw the quick man. He knew that he couldn't tell them he was the quickest of all. Would day that he falls. Now there's too much at stake. Now a cold wind blows. He looked at the crowd and he cried. The moment of truth has arrived. We're gonna draw in this town. I am the law, is what they say true. Does death wear blue? Can he fall? Circuit's slow, I'm not scared anymore. I see the faces of my brothers that have fallen before. My circuit's slow, I'm not scared anymore. Reach for my weapon and in turn you're reaching for yours. My circuit's slow, what they said is a lie. The shots are heard and the bullets scream death as they fly. My circuit's slow, I'm not scared anymore. This is the moment that we have been created for. My circuit's slow, my moment has come. Your speed means nothing if it's death that you're running from. My circuit's slow, I'm not scared anymore. I join the ranks of my brothers that have fallen before. You're too quick on the draw. Burn this town, there is no law. What they say is true, death does wear blue. He can't fall.
What? Alright.
That's the sound of me being right.
You're right. It was. What? That's ridiculous.